Sometimes we get curious about questions we think we can solve simply by checking a book, a website, or something else. Questions like, how tall is the Empire State Building? Or, how big is the moon? We live in a world where everything seems to have been discovered and determined, and for every curiosity we have, we expect a certain and absolutely precise answer. But it's not always like that. If we ask ourselves, for example, which is the largest galaxy in our known universe? Well, we have the bitter surprise of finding ourselves in the quicksand of absolutely imprecise or inconsistent data. You'll get proof of this from this video, which will help you understand the enormous difficulties astronomers face in finding a shared answer. And in the end, you'll realize how pretentious and misleading certain statements are when they say this galaxy is the largest of all. You might not believe it, but until a century ago, galaxies didn't exist. Everything changed on one night in 1923 when Edwin Hubble, peering through the 100-inch telescope at Mount Wilson, identified a Cepheid variable star in the Andromeda Nebula. An incredible stroke of luck, because Cepheids were already known at the time as reliable cosmic candles. These giant stars pulse with a precise rhythm. And already in 1912, Henrietta Swan Leavitt had discovered that the longer their pulsation period, the more intrinsically luminous they are. So by comparing their apparent brightness with what they should have based on their period, astronomers could calculate exactly how far away they were. Thanks to that single pulsating point of light, the universe suddenly expanded thousands of times over. What for centuries had been considered simple gas clouds belonging to the Milky Way revealed themselves to be distant galaxies, islands of billions of stars scattered across a suddenly dizzying cosmos. And with this revolution, a question inevitably arose. How big can these galaxies be? Which is the biggest of them all? Our Milky Way, which for centuries had been our entire known universe, turned out to be a rather modest-sized spiral galaxy. With its 100,000 light-year diameter, it suddenly seemed small when compared to other island universes, as they were once called. Andromeda, the same nebula where Hubble had found the revealing Cepheid, showed a diameter of about 220,000 light-years, more than double the Milky Way. But the measurement was oversized because the distance was underestimated. And this was just the beginning. In 1978, astronomer Alan Dressler of the Carnegie Institute began a systematic study of IC-1101, an object that William Herschel had cataloged as a nebula in 1790, without being able to imagine its true nature. IC-1101 sits at the heart of galaxy cluster Abel 2029, about a billion light-years from us. When Dressler and his team completed measurements using modern techniques, they were stunned. This supergiant elliptical galaxy stretched for at least 6 million light years. To put this number in perspective, consider this. If IC-1101 were centered where our Sun is, it would not only engulf the entire Milky Way, but would extend well beyond Andromeda, which is 2.5 million light years away, and would reach almost to the Triangulum galaxy M33 at 3 million light-years. The entire local group, the set of gravitationally bound galaxies that includes the Milky Way, would fit comfortably inside IC-1101. But how did IC-1101 become so monstrously large? The answer lies in its position in history. Located at the center of a rich galaxy cluster, IC-1101 has had billions of years to fatten up by cannibalizing neighboring galaxies. It's a process called hierarchical accretion. Larger galaxies grow by devouring smaller ones. At the heart of IC-1101 also lies one of the most massive black holes ever discovered, with an estimated mass between 40 and 100 billion times that of our Sun. In the 80s and 90s, other contenders for the throne emerged. ESO-306-17, a fossil elliptical galaxy, so-called because it had already devoured all the galaxies in its neighborhood, showed comparable dimensions. Hercules A, A radio galaxy in the constellation of the same name also revealed dimensions on the order of 1.5 million light years when measured in visible light. But it was in 2013 that a new spiral galaxy champion was crowned, UGC 2885, affectionately nicknamed Rubin's Galaxy, in honor of pioneering astronomer Vera Rubin, who studied galaxy rotation, turned out to be the largest known spiral. With a diameter of 832,000 light-years, it's 8 times larger than the Milky Way and contains about a trillion stars, 10 times more than our galaxy. What makes UGC 2825 particularly interesting is how it grew. Unlike giant elliptical galaxies that grow through violent mergers, UGC 2885 seems to have reached its colossal dimensions more peacefully, accumulating hydrogen gas from surrounding intergalactic space. It's located in a relatively isolated region of space, which may have contributed to its undisturbed growth over billions of years. But now we come to the heart of the matter, to that fundamental problem that makes it so complicated to establish which really is the largest galaxy. The main uncertainty factor in calculating a galaxy's size comes from the difficulty of determining its boundaries. It sounds like a joke, but it's not. Galaxies are complex astronomical objects made up of different elements. Stars first and foremost, obviously, but also masses of neutral and ionized gas, and, at least in spiral galaxies, reserves of interstellar dust that become increasingly diluted as you move away from the center. The mass, excitation state, and distribution of these different materials varies depending on the type of galaxy and its evolutionary history. Their greater or lesser detection depends largely on the instrumentation used. Sizes change with the wavelength of light. A consequence of this variability is that there are galaxies whose dimensions appear larger when observed in visible light rather than infrared, and others that, on the contrary, reveal a larger diameter in infrared than in visible light. In other cases, it's observation in ultraviolet or X-rays that reveals arms or tails of gas and stars totally visible at longer wavelengths. A typical case is the barred spiral galaxy NGC 1512. Arms of young, bright blue stars, probably born from perturbations generated by interaction with the dwarf galaxy NGC 1510, are visible only in far ultraviolet and considerably extend the apparent dimensions of the galaxy observed in visible light. In still other cases, it's observation of a galaxy in radio waves that reveals otherwise invisible structures, such as enormous gas jets extending far beyond the boundaries of the stellar halo, powered by an active galactic nucleus. Hey Curious Squad, before moving on, be sure to subscribe to our channel, clicking on the notification bell, and leave us a thumbs up so you don't miss out on our daily videos. So what is the measurable extent of a galaxy? There's no single answer. It depends on what we decide to observe, that is, which frequencies of the electromagnetic spectrum we include or exclude from the search, and even more importantly, the depth of the observation. The fainter the luminosity that the telescope used can capture in the frequency range to which it's sensitive, the greater, in general, will be the measurable size of the galaxy in that region of the spectrum. This completely brings us to a fundamental distinction. When astronomers talk about the largest galaxies, they usually refer to the extent of their visible stellar component, what we might call the actual body of the galaxy. According to this criterion, the undisputed champions remain two elliptical giants, IC 1101 with its 6 million light-year stellar diameter, and the central galaxy of the Phoenix Cluster, which reaches 2.2 million light-years. The Phoenix Cluster deserves special mention. Discovered in 2010, this galaxy cluster hosts at its center a galaxy that is not only huge, but is also incredibly active in star formation. While most giant elliptical galaxies are dead from a star formation standpoint, the Phoenix Galaxy produces new stars at a frantic rate of about 740 solar masses per year, a star formation rate almost 200 times higher than that of the Milky Way. But here comes the plot twist that shook the astronomy world in February of 2022. An international team of astronomers led by Martin Uy of Leiden University in the Netherlands was conducting a systematic search for giant radio galaxies using data from LOFAR, Low Frequency Array, a network of radio telescopes distributed throughout Europe. LOFAR is particularly suited to detecting low-frequency radio emission, exactly the type of radiation emitted by radio galaxy jets. During this search, which led to the discovery of over 8,000 new giant radio galaxies, one in particular caught the team's attention. In the constellation Lynx, about 3.5 billion light-years from Earth, an extraordinarily large three-component radio structure appeared. After careful checks to exclude that these were separate structures overlapping due to perspective effect, the conclusion was inevitable. They had discovered the largest structure of galactic origin ever observed. They called it Alcyoneus, after the giant from Greek mythology, son of Uranus and Gaia, who according to legend was immortal as long as he remained in his homeland and was defeated by Hercules. An appropriate name for a cosmic titan that redefines our understanding of how large a galaxy can be. The numbers are simply staggering. Alcyoneus's radio jets extend for 16.3 million light-years, or 5 megaparsecs. It's a distance so vast it's difficult to even conceive. To give you an idea of the proportions, consider this. If we consider its radio jets, Alcyoneus is at least 150 times larger than the Milky Way, 4 times larger than IC1101, and its radio lobes alone could comfortably contain hundreds of galaxies the size of ours. If Alcyoneus were centered on Earth, its radio jets would extend well beyond the galaxies of the local group, reaching distances we normally associate with separations between galaxy clusters. But here's the paradox that makes Alcyoneus even more fascinating, and at the same time, controversial. When astronomers examined the host galaxy at the center of this immense radio structure, they found a rather ordinary galaxy. The elliptical galaxy SDSS J08-1421.68 plus 52241.0.0, that's its catalog name, has a total mass of about 240 billion solar masses, half that of the Milky Way. Its central supermassive black hole has a mass of only 400 million solar masses, which is 100 times less massive than the giants found in IC1101 or other supermassive elliptical galaxies. Alcyoneus's radio power isn't exceptional either. It's classified as a low-excitation Fanaroff-Riley Type 2 radio galaxy, which means it gets most of its energy from relativistic processes in the jets rather than from radiation from the active galaxy nucleus. In other words, there's nothing particularly special about the host galaxy that can't explain why its jets have extended so incredibly far. So how is it possible that such a normal galaxy has produced the largest known galactic structure? Astronomers have proposed several hypotheses. One possibility is that Alcyoneus is located in a region of space with particularly low density. In an almost empty environment, the radio jets would encounter little resistance and could expand much more than they would in denser regions. Another hypothesis is that Alcyoneus is located along one of the filaments of the cosmic web, the vast structures of gas and dark matter that connect galaxies on cosmic scales. The particular geometry and density of these filaments could have facilitated the expansion of the jets. There's also the possibility that Alcyoneus's age plays a crucial role. The radio jets could have been active for an exceptionally long time, allowing them to reach these extreme distances. Unfortunately, determining the precise age of radio jets is extremely difficult and remains one of the main challenges in studying radio galaxies. But now we come to the fundamental question, the one many astronomers have asked since the discovery was announced. Is it really correct to define Alcyoneus as the largest galaxy based on the extent of its radio jets? It's a question that touches the very heart of how we define and measure galaxies. Traditionally, when we talk about a galaxy's size, we refer to the extent of its stellar component, the stars, gas, and dust that form the visible body of the galaxy. This is what we see when we observe a galaxy in optical light, and it's what most people imagine when they think of a galaxy. According to this criterion, IC-1101 remains the champion, even if nowhere near the 6 million light-years bandied about by some. Radio jets, on the other hand, are transient phenomena on cosmic scales. Their flows of relativistic plasma expelled from the galaxy's central black hole, propagating through intergalactic space. Although they're certainly produced by the galaxy and carry energy and matter from the galaxy into surrounding space, they're not an integral part of the galactic structure in the traditional sense. They're more like cosmic exhausts than structural components of the galaxy itself. An analogy might be helpful. It's like measuring the size of a city by including the smoke from its chimneys that extends for miles into the atmosphere. The smoke is certainly produced by the city, but would we really say the city is as big as the extent of its smoke plume? On the other hand, radio jets are undeniably part of the galactic phenomena. They carry enormous amounts of energy from the galactic nucleus into intergalactic space, influencing the evolution not only of the host galaxy, but also of the surrounding environment on scales of millions of light years. In this sense, they represent the galaxy's influence and impact on its environment much more dramatically than the stellar component alone does. Furthermore, there's a precedent for including extended structures in the definition of galactic dimensions. Dark matter halos of galaxies, for example, extend far beyond the visible stellar component and are considered an integral part of the galaxy when calculating its total mass. So why shouldn't we consider radio jets, which are much more easily observable than dark matter halos? The astronomical community remains divided on this issue. Many prefer to maintain the distinction between the largest galaxy, IC-1101, based on the stellar component, and the largest structure of galactic origin, Alcyoneus, including radio jets. It's a subtle but important distinction that reflects the complexity of defining the boundaries of objects as vast and multiform as galaxies. What is certain is that Alcyoneus, regardless of how we choose to classify it, represents an extreme phenomenon that challenges our understanding of galaxy physics. How can a relatively modest galaxy produce jets that extend for such cosmic distances? What are the environmental conditions that allow such expansion? And what does this tell us about the relationship between galaxies and the intergalactic medium that surrounds them? The answers to these questions could revolutionize our understanding not only of radio galaxies, but of galaxy evolution in general and the large-scale structure of the universe. Alcyoneus reminds us that, despite decades of observations and theories, the universe still has many surprises in store for us. And so, the crown of largest galaxy remains contested. IC-1101 maintains its primacy as the galaxy with the greatest stellar extent, while Alcyoneus holds the record for the largest structure of galactic origin. It's a distinction that reflects not only the diversity of galaxies in the universe, but also the complexity of defining and measuring cosmic objects that challenge our very capacity for understanding. In the end, perhaps, the real lesson of Alcyoneus isn't which galaxy is the largest, but how much we still have to learn about the universe around us. Every new record, every extraordinary discovery, only opens new questions and reveals new mysteries. And in this sense, Alcyoneus is truly a giant, not just for its physical dimensions, but for the enormity of the questions it raises about the very nature of galaxies and the cosmos.